Hachette Audio presents Presence, bringing your boldest self to your biggest challenges. Written and read by Amy Cuddy. This program contains a Mac and PC compatible bonus PDF.
Epigraph. And you live life with your arms reached out, eye to eye when speaking. Enter rooms with great joy shouts, happy to be meeting. Bright as yellow, warm as yellow. Karen Paris, The Innocence Mission. Introduction. I'm sitting at the counter in my favorite Boston bookstore cafe, laptop open, writing. 10 minutes ago, I ordered coffee and a muffin. The server, a young, dark-haired woman with a broad smile and glasses, paused and quietly said, "I just want to tell you how much your TED Talk meant to me, how much it inspired me. A couple years ago, my professor posted it for a class I was taking. Now I'm applying to medical school, and I want you to know that I stood in the bathroom like Wonder Woman before I took my MCAT, and it really helped. So even though you don't know me, you helped me figure out what I really wanted to do with my life, go to medical school. And then you helped me do what I needed to do to get there. Thank you." Tears in my eyes, I asked, "What's your name?" "Fatane," she said. Then we chatted for the next 10 minutes about Fatane's challenges in the past and newfound excitement about her future. Everyone who approaches me is unique and memorable. But this kind of interaction happens far more frequently than I'd ever have anticipated. A stranger warmly greets me, shares a personal story about how they successfully coped with a particular challenge, and then simply thanks me for my small part in it. They're women and men, old and young, timid and gregarious, struggling and wealthy. But something binds them. All have felt powerless in the face of great pressure and anxiety, and all discovered a remarkably simple way to liberate themselves from that feeling of powerlessness, at least for that moment. For most authors, the book comes first, then the responses. For me, it was the other way around. First, I conducted a series of experiments that gave rise to a talk I delivered at the TED Global Conference in 2012. In that talk, I discussed some intriguing findings from my own and others' research about how our bodies can influence our brains and behavior. By the way, this is where I described that Wonder Woman in the bathroom thing Fatane mentioned, which I will explain by and by, that can quickly increase our confidence and decrease our anxiety in challenging situations. I also shared my own struggles with imposter syndrome and how I learned to trick myself to feel, and actually to become, more confident. I referred to this phenomenon as fake it till you become it. In the talk, that part about my own struggles was almost entirely unplanned and unscripted because I didn't think I had the audacity to disclose something so personal to the hundreds of people in that audience. Little did I know. I didn't know whether these topics would resonate with people. They surely spoke to me. Immediately after that 21-minute video of the talk was posted on the internet, I began hearing from people who had seen it. Of course, watching my talk didn't magically give Fatane the knowledge she needed to do well in the MCAT. She didn't miraculously acquire a detailed understanding of the characteristics of smooth strain versus rough strain bacteria, or how the work energy theorem relates to changes in kinetic energy. But it may have released her from the fear that could have prevented her from expressing the things she knew. Powerlessness engulfs us, and all that we believe, know, and feel. It enshrouds who we are, making us invisible. It even alienates us from ourselves. The opposite of powerlessness must be power, right? In a sense, that's true, but it's not quite that simple. The research I've been doing for years now joins a large body of inquiry into a quality I call presence. Presence stems from believing in and trusting yourself, your real, honest feelings, values, and abilities. That's important because if you don't trust yourself, how can others trust you? Whether we're talking in front of two people or 5,000, interviewing for a job, negotiating for a raise, or pitching a business idea to potential investors, speaking up for ourselves or speaking up for someone else, we all face daunting moments that must be met with poise if we want to feel good about ourselves and make progress in our lives. Presence gives us the power to rise to these moments. The path that brought me to that talk and this breakthrough was roundabout, to say the least. But it's clear where it started. What I most remember were the cartoonish sketches and sweet notes on the whiteboard left by my friends. I'm a sophomore in college. I wake up in a hospital room. I look around, cards everywhere, and flowers. I'm exhausted, but I'm also anxious and agitated. I can barely keep my eyes open. I've never felt like this. I don't understand, but I don't have the energy to try to make sense of it. I fall asleep. Repeat, many times. My last clear memory before waking up in that hospital was of traveling from Missoula, Montana, to Boulder, Colorado, with two of my good friends and housemates. We'd gone up to Missoula to help organize a conference with University of Montana students and to visit with friends. We left Missoula in the early evening, around 6, on a Sunday. We were trying to get back to Boulder for morning classes. In retrospect, especially as a parent, I now see how incredibly stupid this was, given that the drive time between Missoula and Boulder is 13 to 14 hours. But we were 19. We had what we thought was a good plan. We would each drive a third of the trip. One passenger would stay up to help the driver stay awake and alert, while the other passenger would sleep in the back of the Jeep Cherokee, seats down in a sleeping bag. I drove my shift. I think I went first. Then I was the active passenger, keeping an eye on the driver. And it's a really tender memory. So peaceful. I loved these people I was with. I loved the openness of the West. I loved the wilderness. No headlights to count on the highway. Just us. Then came my turn to sleep in the back seat. As I learned later, here's what happened next. My friend was driving the worst shift. It was the time of night when you feel as though you might be the only person in the entire world who is awake. Not only was it the middle of the night, it was the middle of the night in the middle of Wyoming. Very dark, very open, very lonesome. Very little to keep you awake. At around 4 in the morning, my friend veered off the road. When she hit the rumble strip on the shoulder, she overcorrected in the opposite direction. The car rolled several times, eventually landing on its roof. My friends in the front seat were wearing their seatbelts. I, who had been sleeping in the back with the seats down, was ejected from the car and thrown into the night. The right front side of my head slammed into the highway. The rest of me remained in the sleeping bag. I sustained a traumatic brain injury. More specifically, I suffered a diffuse axonal injury, or DAI. In a DAI, the brain is subjected to shearing forces, usually from severe rotational acceleration, which is quite common in car accidents. Imagine what happens during a high-speed car crash. With the sudden and extreme change in velocity upon impact, your body abruptly stops, but your brain continues to move and sometimes even rotate within the skull, which it is not meant to do, and even bangs back and forth against your skull, which it is also not meant to do. The force of my head slamming into the highway, which fractured my skull, probably didn't help matters. The brain is meant to exist in a safe space, protected by the skull and cushioned by several thin membranes called meninges and cerebrospinal fluid. The skull is the brain's friend, but the two are never intended to touch. The shearing forces of a severe head injury tear and stretch neurons and their fibers, called axons, throughout the brain. Like electrical wires, axons are insulated by a protective coating or buffer called the myelin sheath. Even if an axon isn't severed, Damage to the myelin sheath can significantly slow the speed at which information travels from neuron to neuron. In a DAI, the injury occurs throughout the brain, unlike a focal brain injury such as a gunshot wound where damage strikes a very specific location. Everything the brain does depends on neurons communicating. When neurons throughout the brain are damaged, their communication is inevitably damaged as well. So when you have a DAI...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.